Hi, this is Joe Hildreth, and in this episode, or this video, we're going to talk a little bit about fan casting. Working on a series of video on how to make a flask, a fan casting flask, so I thought since those parts are going to be cast, I'll maybe make a little video on making the mold and sand casting and just some of that stuff in general. So the casting sand that I use is natural bonded sand. This actually come out of an aluminum foundry. West me across Tennessee River in Camden. Now this is a very, very fine sand with just the right amount of clay in it to get it to bond and stick together. But generally, to use this as green sand. Green sand means that it's just wet. It's mixed up water, and there's just enough water added to it so that you can squeeze it together. It forms, but it doesn't really stick to your hands. And then to know when the sand is right. If you grab a big handful, squeeze it like into a sausage, this is what everybody tells me anyway, real good, that it should break cleanly. So if that sand is like that, then it's ready to go. Now, to cast, we're going to cast these two little pieces right here. These pieces are 2 inch by 2 inch by half inch angle brackets. They have a draft in them so that they'll pull out the sand cleanly. And we're going to mold them probably side by side just like this and put a sprue right in the middle. So that's what we're going to do. Now, besides the sand, in order to be able to cast, you're going to have a molding flask. A molding flask is just a two-part box that has some sort of guide system. In this case, I'm using wooden pins so that when you put it back together, it goes back and makes everything line. Now, a project that I have coming up requires a match plate, and a match plate is a device that would literally sit between these two and then mold it together and then pulled up and then the match plate taken off. But to do that, I have to have hardware on the end of the flask that will be able to engage both the flask and the match plate. So again, that's what these are for. There will be a half inch rod that will stick out of one of these and a half inch hole on the other. And then if we say this is the side of the flask, the pin will stick through and then see, you'll be able to guide it. And then the pin will come over here that could slide through my match plate and also slide into this bracket. All right, so we're going to mold this up. This is really pretty simple. Two parts of a flask. One part is called the cope and one is called the drag. And I don't know if there's really a difference. I think the drag is the one that's considered on the bottom. Okay, so we're going to take this, the cope half, and set it off to the side. And we're going to set a molding board here off to the side. Okay, so now in addition to your pattern and your flask, you're going to have a couple molding boards. And this is just something that's nice and smooth that you can pick up the mold on and mold your pattern on. So I'm going to gather a few things together, and then we'll start the process. Okay, now the sand, when we go to ram it up, it will stick to itself. So we have to have something that will separate, that we can put between the sand, so that it won't stick to the pattern or to itself. So I use a commercial release agent. You can use talcum powder. I've seen people use Diamascus earth. I've seen people use very fine silica sand. But you know, you buy a 10 pound thing of this from Budget Casting Supply and it will last you forever and it works great. So we're going to start by placing our patterns down here. And remember I said that I was going to mold them about like this, and let me get an idea here where I can set it, because I gotta have enough space between there to get my sprue. So I want to set it about like that. Okay, now I'm gonna give these a good fine dusting with powder, just to keep the sand from sticking to it. And you notice that I dust this without putting the drag of the flask on. The reason why I've done that is because I don't really want the powder on this here, because I actually want the sand to sort of stick to the flask. So we're going to lay this down here about where we want it. And we're going to start putting some sand in there. We're going to use a thing called a riddle, which I put somewhere right here. And we're going to sift this first sand that we put in there, make sure that there's no trash in it, lumps or anything like that. So I'm just going to scoop some sand in here and shake it up here. I'm really just kind of interested in covering the pattern a little bit. With the patterns covered there, I'm just going to take a rod. This is just a piece of dowel rod. I'm just going to kind of drive this all around the edges and pack that sand. And I'm going to hold on to my pattern because I don't really want them to jump around. Like so. There's a piece of trash. Get rid of that. Now, Tubal Cain, he's got a lot of videos on this, and so does My First Boy. I would encourage you to check those out. I am a rank amateur when it comes to sand casting. But if you look at those two guys' channels, you'll see a lot of great information. Now, we're just going to heap some sand in here. Oh, you stuck so much there. Pack that down. We're going to ram this down, just like this. Again, trying to make sure that we don't disturb those patterns too much. And we're going to continue this process until it's rammed full. We'll get some more sand here. And, you know, a lot of people say, well, how hard do you ram? Well, you know, I really don't know. I just pack it good and tight. I suppose if you pack it too tight that it won't let the hot gases escape, and you'll see that as bubbles on top of or against the casting. So we're going to finish filling this up. And we're going to overfill it so that it's humped up. And then we're going to strike it off. And I apologize for the poor audio, video, sound, light, the whole ball of wax. I'm not a videographer. My son Zachary is kind enough to run my pad there to get some video. I got a nice camera, but I don't have a FireWire card to pull it off on the computer. All right, so this is just a piece of metal, and we're just going to use this to just kind of strike this off, like so. This is just a screwed together flask. So it's not a very good one. So I'll try to get this excess sand over here back in the box. Just going to take this, and I'm just going to lift this up, and I'm set it off to the side here so I can clean up my sand, and then I'll show you. Hopefully you can hear me. My wife tells me I mumble all the time, and she's probably right. Probably where I'm just getting old and deaf. Okay, so we have this half. So you see our two patterns there. Now, remember, we don't want the sand to stick to each other, so we're gonna dust this again. Like I said, this prevents the sand from sticking. Yeah. Liberal there. It's the only thing that's liberal about me is my use of farting dust. The rest of me is kind of ultra-conservative. One of them right-wing maniacs, I think they call me. I'm not sure. You know, you're pro-life and pro-fiscal responsibility, and next thing you know, you're a radical or something. So this is the top. So this is the cope. We're just going to lay that on there like that. And we're going to take this is a piece of broom handle or dowel. Actually, this is a maybe 5/8, 3/4 inch dowel. And I'm just going to push that into the sand a little bit in there, right between them, just like that. And I'm just going to use this little one here because I don't want to bump the dowel. So we're just going to, again, shake some more sand in here until we cover it real good. You know, about an inch. This is a little fine, but it'll work. Okay. And then we're going to scoop some sand in here, just like we did before. So I can take this too. Alright, now the stick that I just stuck in here, this is our sprue hole. This is actually where we're going to pour the metal in. We want to take care not to bump that. We're going to dry this, ram the sand all around here. And then we're going to fill this up just like we did the drag half. So, bear with me and I need to make a new molding bench and a little sled for it. So, so I can get to the sand here. So, make sure you pack it around the edges. Get that good and firm. If you don't get it packed well, the soft sand could actually fall out of the halves. They call that a dropout. Although, when it happens to me, I usually have a whole lot of other names for it other than dropout, most of which I can't repeat in mixed company, in case there's any ladies watching. So, just saying, I'm an old sailor, and I've learned quite a few expressions in my day, I guess, but anyway. So, again, we're going to overfill this, just like we've done the last one. Now, a regular rammer usually has a big wide end and then a wedge on the other end. I need to make one. We just recently got a wood lathe that we acquired. I was giving a guy a table saw that I went to church with. I thought he could use it. And it kind of felt like I had to have a wood lathe, but I don't have a cup and spur for it. So, all right, again, we're going to strike this off. Like we've done last time. Yeah. Like I said, this is not really rocket science. If you ever built sandcastles, I think you could do this. If it was too hard, I probably couldn't do it. And I do want to maybe clean that up just a little bit, so I'm just kind of screeding it there. That didn't do much for it, did it? Alright. Alright, so now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get a couple tools out here. These little palette brushes that you could buy like at Hobby Lobby or Michael's or any of the craft stores, these are great for cutting sprue holes and stuff like that. So I'm just going to take here and kind of carve. Actually, I think I just used a spoon. I'm just going to carve around here and make a funnel shape around my sprue. Okay, just like that. Okay, and then maybe slick it a little. Okay. All right. We'll clean that up more here in just a minute. So now, I'm just going to hold that and bump it and loosen that up so that I can pull that out without really breaking up the sand. All right, so I'm going to have Zachary stop, and then let me clean some of the sand out of the way so we can give you a better look, and then we'll pick it up from there. Okay, so we pulled the sprue pin out. I just want to get some of the sand out of the way here and match this, firm that up real good. So now we're going to separate it. So we're going to very gently pull the cope straight up. I'm just going to lay it back over here on the side. And you can see that it's just, I guess you can see, the imprints where the two pieces were. So now I'm going to take a little palette knife, and you see the little print there where we push the sprue pin in there. So we're going to cut channels over to our pieces that we want to cast so that the metal can flow to them. Okay. These are called gates. I'm just going to slice in there. Not really far. My pattern's only half inch thick, so I really don't want to get too deep. All right. Clean up my finger. Here's where a little bellows or something would be handy. But I'm just packing this so that the sand won't break free. Let me cut the other side here. Like I said, I like these little things here. I need to get some more. They make several different types. Now, if your sand's kind of weak, you could actually take and moisten that with a soft brush. But I'm just going to turn it like that. Loose sand is your enemy, because if it's loose here, it's just going to float around with the metal and stick in your casting. So the next thing we do, we need to remove these, okay? And how we're going to do that is we're just going to gently tap them. A little bit. And I'm going to put a screw in here, a hole for a screw. Drop that in there. And we're going to very gently bump and nudge that until these are, I can see them moving in the print. And then with a little luck, we can pull that straight up like that. That's the first one out. Something I'm going to tell you about pattern making. You want to make these, take all the time in the world to make your patterns, make them very, very smooth and slippery. They're just so much better. Be mindful of taper in order to, graft on the pattern, and undercuts, because those are your enemies. So now, if we're not lucky with this one here, I'm just kind of vibrating it. Not much more than the weight of the screwdriver bouncing on there. Put the screw in. And again. I kind of like to use this. I made this years ago. And very gently pull that out. So there we go. So that's our cavity that we're going to cast into. Now,
where I have this fresh sand. I'm going to clean up this. Maybe. I'm just going to clean that up slightly. Okay. With that sharp edge, I'm afraid it'll wash in. Should have a bellows. I'm not sure what's going on there, guys. All right. So now, I'll take a little parting dust here and dust those areas that I just exposed, and then try to get blown out real good. All right. Always better safe than sorry, I think. Okay. Got some buggered up down there, but I think for what we're making, it'd be okay. All right. So now, all we have to do is put the top back on, and this one is ready to cast. So I have these marked, one side marked A and one side marked B. I think that side is A. That way I know it goes back together the same. Now this is a very simple mold, it's flat bottom, and very easy to do. Okay, so that's all to this part. Let's go set up the furnace and the casting area and get some metal melting and go from there.
Okay, well, we got all the stuff out to start casting, and we'll come over this. We'll go over this just a little bit. If we come over here, this is just a 5-gallon bucket. The refractory lining is made out of cement, clay, and perlite. It's just insulated around the edge and across the bottom. There's a hole comes to the side, sort of at a tangent. I just use this old piece of pipe to get my little plastic blower a little further out. And if you look here on the inside, you'll see that the burner down here comes in as a tangent. I don't know if you can see that or not. So the very first thing we're going to do, now we're melting with charcoal. So the very first thing we're going to do is we're going to put in a layer of charcoal. And this is the top I cut off the bag. And it burned quite well too. So we're just going to get us a couple of good layers of charcoal in there. I'm going to go about to the top of the pipe. There, and let's smooth all this out real good. Just like that. Now I'm going to soak that down with some starter fluid. Now remember, the stuff's flammable, so once we got this process going, make sure you move your starter fluid out of the way. I like to use quite a bit here, and I'm just going to let that soak into those bricks for a few minutes. Put this over here. Just 10 feet away. Okay. Alright. Now I'm going to let that soak, and while that's soaking, we'll talk about some of the other stuff. The crucible that I use is just a 4-inch piece of heavy wall pipe with the bottom welded to it. A couple of bolts welded to the side. A little loop on the back, and it's just got a pore lip crimped into it. The guy that made that for me was kind enough to crimp it down for me. To handle the crucible, I have these two little tools here. This one here is a little forked piece here that I can come over here beside these bolts, pick it up, and then this little hook right here, I can grab this here, and then of course I got control over the pour. So that's important. This stuff's about 1200-1400 degrees. So you need to be very, very careful and plan everything out. So what we see here, the lid to the furnace has a couple fire bricks to set it on when I need to set it off to the side. And then when we're ready to pour, we're always moving this direction. So I'll pull out the metal. We'll come over to the mold that we just made, which is covered here to keep anything from getting in it. We'll pour it in there, and then any metal left in the flask, we're just going to pour in the muffin tins. Now, these make great ingot molds, but if you're going to use those, if you actually go like to the dollar store and buy a used one or whatever, fill it up full of water, set it outside, and let it rust.
really good because it's a, otherwise if it's got the nonstick and it's not rusted, they kind of stick, actually. And nobody likes sticky muffins. You know what I'm saying? Well, you know what I'm saying. All right, so this probably soaked long enough. We're going to flame this off, maybe. I can figure out how to work the lighter. I quit smoking about, I don't know, 15 years ago or so, and don't use a lighter much these days unless I'm grilling. And, all right, so we're going to let that burn, and then when that catches real good, I will put a little air to it to get it going. So again, I'll put the lighter over here with the starter. So that's out of the way. And I don't know if you can hear me. I'll annotate the video, I guess, if you can't. And so as soon as that gets started, we'll come back. Okay, so this layer of charcoal is starting real good. There's a lot of white spots. Well, I took, I don't know, maybe 5 minutes, 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. You let it get burning real good, put the air to it, and, you know, kind of feed it a little bit, turn the air off. Do that a couple times, and no time is going. Now, for air source, a lot of folks use fans or vacuum motors or blow dryers. This is just one of those little cheap $10 or $20, you know, air mattress pumps. It seems to work pretty good for me. Probably not hot enough to do brass or that, but it works great for aluminum, and that's what we're doing here. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take our crucible, and I'm just going to set it right down here in the middle of these coals and kind of get it all nestled in there, make it feel warm and at home. Now I'm going to take charcoal bricks, and I want to fill this thing up. Really, the only way to do this is by hand because it's hot. Mind your fingers. And I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to rock this forward so I can get some behind it. Even it out here. So. Like I said, metal casting is not rocket science. It's reasonably quiet when it's burning. There's not even any smoke. The neighbors haven't complained yet. Although, the way I see it, it's my property. What I do on it's my business. I don't give a shit if they like it or not. But, no sense of being negative, right? So, now, I'm able to stick my hands down in here now because this is pretty cold, comparatively speaking. As we fire this up, it will get quite hot. We'll have to add more charcoal to it. I won't be able to put my hands in there near close as like I am now without gloves. Alright. I think that's good. Now, we'll hit the air and get this going. Okay, so while I'm waiting for that to catch, we're just going to turn on the air and let this catch. And now, while that's doing that, I'm actually just going to set this on here. Warm air is coming out here, very hot air now. And I'm going to take just scrap aluminum, either a couple screws, and set them up here. Now, see, we've done these before, but I messed them up. So. Nice thing about metal casting is if you screw it up, well, melt it down and try it again. So I'll set that up here, and I got a couple more muffin pans and set that. And then we're just going to make sure that's good and dry, because once that gets going good, we don't want to put no moist metal in there to blow up. So they instantly flash steam and then throw molten metal all over. Well, that's, they say it's not good. So all right, when this gets started, we'll come. Okay, we're going to pull this off and see how this is starting up. Oh, yeah, they're looking pretty good. And all right, we're good. So now all we're going to do is keep the lid on it and keep the air to it until the stuff melts down, and we'll add more to it. So we'll come back as needed. So we'll just keep this fired up. Okay, so I'm going to turn off the air. We've been cooking here now for about 10 minutes, and we're gonna pull this off. See what we got so far. All right, so we look in there. We see that there's aluminum is melting, and we're gonna put some more in there. And I like to use tongs whenever we use this stuff. Okay, I'm gonna put this sprue in there, and using a pair of tongs, so very gently set that down in there. We don't want to freeze it. Yeah, I think we got room for another one here. Go ahead and put that one in. So, maybe. Alright, it's pretty hot. Alright, so now, but we're going to get some more charcoal in there. Always got to watch your fuel levels. And get on these fairly thick gloves. These were given to me by a coworker of mine, who's a firefighter, and he says, man, these are good gloves, and they really are able to get my hands around it. Although they are kind of bulky and hard to use. But like I said, I just want to see it. A lot of heat in there still. And let me get that heated up. Now the goal here is just to melt it just enough to get it all melted, and then superheat it a little bit so we can pour it, and that should be enough for that. Alright, so we're going to cover this back up, put the blast back on it probably for about another 5 minutes, and we'll come back and I think we'll be able to skim it and pour. So we'll see you here in just a few minutes. Okay, so it's been about another 5 minutes. We're going to kill the air here. And I think we're about ready to pour. We're going to pull a lid off. Once the thing gets hot, it doesn't really take long. Oh yeah, it looks really good. So, got to skim the dross. That's the burnt stuff there on the top. We just want to scrape that off, and I find this dollar store spoon the perfect thing to do that. We don't really want that running into our mold, so probably should have preheated the spoon, but it is what it is. Okay, now I'm going to pour this. Now look, I don't want any of you safety Nazis telling me here about my tennis shoes or my no long sleeves or protective wear. Look, I get it. I'm also a guy of personal responsibility, so guess what? If I burn myself, it's my responsibility, not yours. All right, so time to pour the mold. And we're going to pour it as fast as it takes metal until it is full. Right, like that. We're going to take the rest here. We're going to make some shiny aluminum muffins. A little moisture on that pan. You see it boiling out. All right. So there we go. Put this back in here to keep it hot because I actually got to make two of these. But you get the idea here. And, all right. So when this cools down, it's going to take about 10 or 15 minutes or so. We can shake it out over here in the mold. We'll shake it out, and we'll see how our work turned out. So we'll catch you here in just a few minutes. Okay, so we brought the mold in, and we're going to shake it out. It's been about 10 minutes. These are kind of small, so maybe I get away with it. Usually you probably want to wait, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. Just depends on the size of the casting. But again, like I said, these are pretty small, so let's knock this out and see what we got. And keep in mind, it's still very, very hot. Part. Go ahead and knock the sand out. All right, let's get this hand. All right, and grab the sand off of it here. I didn't grab a pair of pliers. I wasn't thinking ahead, but we'll knock this sand off of here. Steam's coming up, steaming up my glasses. Well, there we have it. Freshly molded and cast angle brackets. So, thanks for watching. And look, I feel like I have to say this. Metal casting is inherently a dangerous activity. A spatter of water hitting the molten aluminum would cause a flash steam, throwing molten metal everywhere, which is dangerous. You should use leather shoes. Should have something to protect your legs and your hands and your arms. Now, I didn't follow my own practice. Now, the other side of this is, look, if you're an idiot, right, if you can't take personal responsibility and that sort of stuff, this type of activity is probably not for you. Probably shouldn't even watch it. So, but other than that, if you exercise great safety, caution, it's not a hard activity. It's a lot of fun. God bless you, and have a great day.